Good evening, everyone. As you remember, that we started a series last week, and already I had tons of great comments about it, for the Hebrew one and for the English one. I started it in the same week. As you know, after here I have another lecture. This lecture will be for Refuat Shlema Be'ezrat Hashem of Yunita Bat Avigail and all the other people who need Refuat Shlema. So today it's the continuation of the series, The Psychology of the Mind of the Soul. And it's part two today. Just to refresh your memory, last week we finished approximately about what happened when there is a person that is broken and he feels that he made a horrible sin that basically took away all his energy, and he comes and he asks, you know, about his situation. The question is, how do you bring him up? And we concluded that, you know, in Chovot Alvavot, which is a very important book of speaking a lot about emunah and confidence in Hashem, you know, that we explain the concept of osim tshuva. In Shulchan Aruch it says that when a person is in the process of doing tshuva, it means he got on the right track. Although he did not reach his destination, if the fact that he got on the right track already, even if he died in the middle of the process, it's already someone that was already doing tshuva. Unlike the Rambam, that his shita is more strict, it's written in the Torah, Veshamata bekol Hashem Elokecha, you know, Veshavta ad Hashem Elokecha, Veshamata bekolo. You return all the way to your God, not halfway, and you have to hear, to listen to him. Both ways, it's really, although it's not the same exact shita, Rabbeinu Yonah and the Rambam, they're both two of the Gedolei HaRishonim that lived more than 850 years ago. But the concept is that a person that already made a turn in his direction, that second, his entire future changed immediately, even if it take a minute. And I gave an example, if you remember, of someone that left Jerusalem on the way to Tzfat, to the north, and accidentally he went to Be'er Sheva or to the south. He got the wrong exit and he went south instead of north. And now he found out that he was all the way to the opposite direction. So the minute he found out, he made a U-turn, and now he's 4 hours away from Tzfat. When he left Jerusalem, he was 2 hours away. Now when he made the U-turn in Be'er Sheva over there in the south, he has to go all the way to the north. It's 4 hours. And I ask, on which two periods the person is in a better condition? When he left Jerusalem and he entered the road to the wrong direction, it was only 2 hours away from Tzfat, but he was going to the opposite direction. Or when he actually found out that he's in the opposite direction and he made the U-turn, but now he has 4 hours ride as opposed to 2 hours ride. And I explain that although you may think that when he was 2 hours away from his destination, his situation was better than now when he's 4 hours away, I understand that according to Hashem, it's the other way around. He's in a much better condition when he's 4 hours away, because now he found out his mistake and he finally headed to the right direction, meaning he's now gonna get there eventually, but at least he's on the right direction. So it's very interesting, because in life, the way we think, a person that is investing money, let's say, he start with $100,000, and now he went down to $200,000, his investment. And you know, so when he invested the first original $100,000, later on he became $200,000. Which one of the 2 points he's in a better condition, you may say, when he only invested 100. Now he's losing 200. That's not true. Why? Because when he invested 100, he did not know if he's going to make profit or not. He could have lost it all. Now, when he already invested 100, he saw that he needs to invest another 100 in order for him to begin to make profit. Once he's going to invest another 100, he's going to start seeing profit. So he invested 200, now it's 200,000 out of his pocket. But once he concluded the store and the merchandise and this, now he begin to sell. He makes profits. So it's true that right now he's in a negative balance of $200,000, but now he's making money every day. Very, very soon, he's going to come to zero balance and then positive balance, and he's going to make millions. So it doesn't matter where you are temporarily. It matters what the future is holding for you. This is the concept of tshuva. And that's the shita of Rabbeinu Yonah. That once you found out and you right away stepped into the right track, from there on, you already consider a Baal tshuva. Although you are very, very far from concluding the mission, as long as you got on the right direction, you're already Baal tshuva. So that's a very, very good news. Especially for people that have a weak heart. That when today someone called me, I said, Rabbi, listen, you know, I always defend you with my friends. He lives in a very modern, rich neighborhood, one of the richest neighborhoods in America. There's a lot of modern Orthodox. They're more secular than religious, this kind of people, if you know what I mean. And he has friends, and obviously this kind of modern people with their secular education, and they think that, you know, America is really the place for them. So he's always arguing with them about some of the things that I say in my lectures. Of course, they always have the liberal modern approach, but this kid is a pure soul. Although he himself is modern in his behaving, in the way he dress, in his lifestyle, but he has a different heart than this kind of people. He knows what's the truth. When he hears the truth, he always admits. So today he called to complain that he heard one of my lectures from a few years ago about Zera Levatala, Tikkun HaBrit, wasting seed. And he said to me, it was based on the Ari HaKadosh and the Kabbalah, he said to me, you know, I always defend you, my friends, when they hear it, they don't want to hear it, you know. They always have what to say negative. And I always, you know, I always take your side. But between me and you, it's really scary, he said today. Meaning he's already one leg with them. He would hope that they are right. The losers, you know, hopefully they're right and not the rabbi. Why? Because he's thinking about his future, about his situation. So I say to him, listen, you know me by now. When I say something, it's not me. It's 100%, it's written in one of the holy books. I don't make up things. I just say what I learn. I learn it somewhere. I don't just sit and think, what today I will invent? Let's think. Maybe I have a great imagination. Let's invent names of angels and how the Gehenom looks and the color of the fire and the temperature and which kind of people will end there, and let me make it a little bit juicy and I add a little bit more. This is how it goes. I only tell you what the book says. But then I told him, but then, if you already stop making sins, meaning no more pogem babrit, and you already regret it and you're ashamed, and you're already heading towards the first Yom Kippur that is coming, although you have who knows how many millions of sins, but you already mityatzev al darkei tshuva, you already got on the right track. So Hashem is taking it into consideration. It's much, much, much different than before you get on the right direction. Therefore, we don't have permission ever to give up. We cannot give in. We got to do everything we can. Even a partial tshuva will make the situation sometimes 1,000 times better. You understand? Don't forget, there's always a possibility of reincarnation. Now we're going to come back to the world and the next life will fix what we didn't fix yet. And there's always the possibility of going to Gehenom, which will be a dry clean for the soul. With all the suffering and the pain, it will end. It will not last forever. And once it will end, we will finish. That's it. We're done. And now we go to a very great place. And from then on, only pleasure, non-stop pleasure. So the idea is, if you do the right thing, eventually, whether you finish it fully or Hashem will finish it for you, with pain or without pain, one way or the other, you have to know that eventually it will end. But if you give up, you basically sentence yourself for total destruction. You don't have permission to give up or to give in. All right, so we move on. Aval bama tiyeh atshuva me'adam. Let's read some of the things here. We try to analyze it. In Chovot HaLevavot, Shar HaTshuva, Gate of Repentance, Chapter 3. Aval bema tiyeh atshuva me'adam, omar bazeh. כי תיתכן לו אחר הקדמת ידיעתו בשבעה דברים. חובות הלבבות, for those of you who speak Hebrew, it's a very hard language. It's language of 800 years ago. It's not, so you have to understand, you have to translate it to a language that we will understand what it means. So it says like this, אבל במה תהיה התשובה מהאדם? אומר בזה, this is what I'm going to say, how is the תשובה of the person will be? תיתכן לו אחר הקדמת ידועתו בשבעה דברים. What, once a person found out that he's heading to the wrong direction, what would happen from now on? It's going to explain. שידע גנות מעשהו ידיעה ברורה. The first thing, person has to recognize the bad actions that he just committed clearly. For instance, it was Mechalel Shabbat, and someone told him, you're not allowed to break Shabbat. What do you mean? He said, you're not allowed to light fire, you're not allowed to drive the car, you're not allowed electric, you're not allowed borer, you're not allowed to sew, you're not allowed to write, you're not allowed to use the computer, all these things. Thank you very much. So he says, oh, okay, so if I'm not allowed to break Shabbat, I'm going to start keeping Shabbat. Is it good enough or no? What do you think? Okay. So I find out that I was Mechalel Shabbat and it's not allowed. I didn't know. Now I know. I'm going to start keeping Shabbat. I'll come with you to Shul. And I'll come to your house for Shabbat. From now on, I'll be Shomer Shabbat. Is this considered Tshuva or no? What do you think? That's a very good step forward to the right direction. That's called mityatzev al darkei hatshuva. But as far away from being complete. Why? In order for you to repent for your bad sins, you have to learn the level of the sins that you committed. If you don't know the sins, you won't know how to do tshuva for them. For instance, if you stole money, How in the world you know how to do tshuva without learning the rules? First, you have to know what the punishments of someone who steals. What is it? He has to pay double. How do you do tshuva for it? You don't need to pay double. You can pay the original amount you stole or the exact item that you stole. But it's not enough. You have to also learn that you have to go to the person and to apologize to him for the aggravation you caused him. And you know, and if it's money, you have to pay him the full amount. If you don't pay it, you can never make tshuva. Unless if he tells you, I forgive you. You don't have to pay me back. It's good. I forgive you. It's enough. Then you don't have to pay back. But how in the world you will know how to do tshuva before learning how severe it is and what's the correction for it? So this is what he's saying here. Yeda gnut ma'asehu yediyah brura. You have to learn the weight of the sins that you committed, they're not all weighed the same. Now, if you've just learned that you're breaking Shabbat, you didn't know it's not allowed. Every Shabbat, you take the lemon pit out of the salad. Israeli salad, you see the peat, you pick it up with your hands, and you throw it out. You take the bad out of the good. You make it, the mixture, you make it perfect. That is a violation of Shabbat. You're not allowed to do it. You're allowed to take the good out of the bad, but not the bad out of the good. Or you're allowed to take the good and the bad together out of the good. Meaning, if you want to take the peat out, take a spoon, take the peat with some tomatoes and cucumbers with it. Now, when it's already in a spoon, you throw it out, and then you can take back the tomato and the cucumbers and put it back in a bowl. It's all in the mind. It's nothing to do with the hard work or efforts or anything like that. So now, if you would not know that what you're committing, it's a violation of Shabbat, would you ever know to do tshuva for it? Of course not. Someone just told you on the table, oh, what are you doing? You're not allowed to take the peat out. You just broke Shabbat. It's like lighting fire, the same thing. Same punishment, same everything. Wow, really? I didn't know. Wow, I'm so sorry. Okay, now what do you do now? First, you have to understand that breaking Shabbat, it's not stealing $2 from your friend. It's not the same level. You understand? Or it's not like eating something not kosher. It's not the same level. That's a very, very high level of a sin. And if you did it not intentionally, you have to bring a sacrifice to Beit HaMikdash, which is hundreds of dollars, and wasting your whole entire day or week back in the time to get to Jerusalem would be a week to get there and a week to come back. It's a very severe way to repent, very expensive also. So now you're learning the value and the way of the sin and how to fix it. If you did it intentionally, meaning someone already told you back in time that you're not allowed to do it, and you did it anyway, and now it just attacked you, and you say, wow, look at me, it's the second time I'm doing it. I already got a warning. Now it's already considered on purpose. It's death penalty. It's no joke. Now you have to do tshuva for it. Serious. Serious problem now. It's Isur Karet. Now you know you're going to receive suffering. You need to know all these things. So you know now suffering is due to come. Be clever. Let me give a lot of charity. That will prevent suffering. Why? If I work all day and I make $200 and I just give $1,000 donation, I actually give 5 days of my life. I actually sacrifice 5 days of work of my life for that 1 minute sin that I did, or 10 second sins. That's definitely, it's a lot of suffering that I just gave. Instead of taking the money, I give it out. So I work 5 days for nothing, for free. That's a big suffering, right? 5 days, 10 hours a day, or 9 hours a day. Many, many hours of working for free. That comes instead of being sick, instead of a car accident, instead of having problem with the children, instead of divorce, instead of IRS, instead of court, instead of all kinds of other problems, police, arrest, all these things that people have. So here you go. How would you ever know to be clever and to fix it quick and clean if you don't learn the way of the sin and how to handle it? That's why you need to learn. So that's the first one. Yeda gnut ma'aseh yedi'ah brura. Clear knowledge. Clear knowledge. Is this lashon hara or no? What I just say was mitzvah or avera, Rabbi? It was mitzvah to warn from this person, or I didn't have the right to warn from him? I warned anyway, but I want to know now if I broke the rule or not. Sometimes it will be lashon hara, sometimes it will be mitzvah. No, you have to say it. You have to warn people. He's a thief, he's stealing from people. You have to warn them. Not always you have to warn. In shiduchim, somebody call you and ask you about this girl, and you know something about her. From 10 years ago, she wasn't 100%. But 10 years, she's functioning perfectly. Who told you you're allowed to mention? If it was in the last few months, there's always a possibility that it didn't go away. 10 years, she's functioning fine. Everything is fine. She's healthy. Everything is normal. Now you're mentioning that 10 years ago, of course he's going to get scared. Who told you that you're allowed to ruin people's life? You shouldn't do it. Some things you want to hide, you're not allowed to hide. If a person has psychiatric history, you have to say it. You cannot hide it, even if it's your own brother. You want him to get married very fast, but you're a fool. Do you think by hiding it, you're helping it? You're helping him? You're only going to make the situation worse. He's going to get married, and then he's going to have an attack. The girl would leave him. He's going to have a baby somewhere, and he's not even going to be able to see him because she's going to get angry why nobody ever told her that he was hospitalized and taking medication, right? So out of anger, his situation will be a lot worse. I know a lot of people like that. You fooled me. You lied to me. You didn't tell me the story before the wedding. I will take revenge against you for the rest of my life. So what did he do? He suffered a lot more now. He has a kid or two and he cannot see them. Happens all the time. So some of the things is mitzvah. Some of the things is avera. If you won't learn, you will never know. So that's first thing. You have to know the gnut. How bad, how derogatory is what you did. Okay. כי אם לא יתברר לו זה, ויהיה מסתפק או שוגג בלתי מזיד, he won't know if it's intentional or not intentional sin. לא תיתכן החרטה ממנו עליו. The regret level will not be accurate. It will not be accurate. So if you did something not intentional and you thought that it's intentional and you repent for intentional, no, you did more than you had to. At least you cover the problem. But if you thought that it's unintentional and it was intentional, you made tshuva for unintentional, but you had to do a much, much, much bigger tshuva, which you never did. The sin is still in your file. You did not erase it. You understand? ובקשת המחילה בו, כמו שכתוב, it's written in Tehillim, in Psalms 51, verse 5, כי פשעי אני אדע וחטאתי נגדי תמיד. דוד רוט, דוד המלך, כי פשעי אני אדע, I know my sins, וחטאתי נגדי תמיד, and my not intentional sins are always in front of me. Meaning, I know very well my intentional sins that I did, and I also know my not intentional sins, meaning not only I know exactly what I did wrong, I have it in front of me every minute of my life. It's not something that happened and I forgot about it and I moved on with my life. No. But the way that David wrote it in two different languages, Pshai, Chatai, Chatati. Why? Just say one thing. That's it for the whole thing. We got the point. Why you have to break it to two categories? The answer, because it's the whole different thing. Intentional sins and not intentional sins. There are three major reasons, that because of them, a person is thinking that he cannot change. How many times you come to speak to a teenager or an adult, and you say to them, you can do it, you can do it, you can change. It doesn't mean you can stay like this forever. And he said, no, no, I can't. That's the way I am. That's it. There's no way I can change. That's my nature. Zeh ha-teva sheli. That's my nature. I cannot change. And you try to convince him, no, no, you can change. Look at Reuven, he changed. Look at Shimon, he changed. No, no, no. I know myself. I cannot change. When a person speaks like that, we have a problem. Remember what I said last week? When we have a problem, how do we address the problem? Who remembers? How do you address a problem in life? Very good. Today, most people make mistake. They go and they treat the symptom of the problem. Symptom. You don't want to deal with the symptom. You want to go to the root of the problem and fix it over there. If you only fix what the symptoms is right now, it's just a matter of time until the problem will hit again. You're not solving the problem, right? I give you an example. You have a kid that uses drugs. When kids use drugs, they steal money from their parents. It always goes together, because they can't control their crave anymore. So what happened? So the father say, I know my son will come to steal any minute. Let me make sure the money is all locked in a safe. He locked the money in a safe and the kid came to look for money and he couldn't find it. The problem, the father solves what problem? The symptom only. Meaning, the kid wants to come to steal, that's gonna be the reaction of his disease. And the father took measurement to prevent his stealing. But did he take care of the root of the problem? No. The root of the problem that he has a sick kid that needs to get out of his sickness. He did not handle the problem. So he didn't steal from him. He's going to go and rob a car on the street now. What's the way to handle it? To go to the root of the problem and cure it from there. That he would not need drugs, which would not lead him to steal. Forever, you will never have to worry about it once you cure the root of the problem, even if it's difficult. People only think, let's pass the moment. Let's just survive another day. That's not the way to end a life. You have to go to the root of the problem. So when a person comes and tells you, he tells you, I cannot change. What's behind it? You have to understand. Why this kid or adult is telling me that he cannot change? What caused him to feel and to say it? Maybe he's lying. Maybe he really means it. If he means it, what caused him to feel like that? We have to know the root of it. Three things could be the reasons why a person say that he cannot change, or he thinks that he cannot change. One is fear. Fear. Second, imagination. Third, habits. Remember, you can watch it later on, it's going to be tomorrow online, you can make notes. Very important to know every detail in this series. If you want to really succeed in life and in everything else you do. Three things cause a person to come to the conclusion that he cannot change, which is a devastating conclusion. It's a disaster. It's a very, very big danger. Why? Because if a person came to the conclusion that he cannot change, that means he agree from now on to do nothing about his problems. That's the way I am. I'm an angry wolf. I'm a dirty person. I'm a lazy bum. I'm a useless human being. I'm an addict. I'm mentally sick. Whatever his case is. I'm skinny, I'm fat, I'm slow, I'm retarded. Everyone with what he thinks about himself. This is the self-esteem of the person. Let's analyze each one of the three. Please pay attention carefully. First one, imagination. Imagination is one of the strongest powers that affect our behaving. In everything we do in life, there's always the aspect of imagination. The imagination is controlling many of our actions. If you take it out of the life of a person, the life of a person changes drastically. It's also a very necessary power that Hashem puts in the mind of a person. And a person will be able to imagine things. It helps him sometimes for good, sometimes unfortunately for bad. Depend the balance and the timing. Too much imagination, dangerous. Too little, dangerous. The right amount, positive. Very good. You understand? So too much, person living illusions until it explodes in his face. Not enough is not as creative. He doesn't take actions. He doesn't try. He doesn't dream. That's not good also. It has to be the right way. So let me give you an example. Imagination is one of the strongest powers that affect the behaving of the human being. The imagination can twist the truth. Can twist it completely. It can make a person unable to recognize his real abilities. it can confuse a person to a level that he does not evaluate himself correctly. I give you an example of imagination when a person imagining things. A person speaks to a girl before they go on a date. Someone introduces them. He speaks to her on the phone. And then after that, you know, she told him one word that can be translated in different ways. Maybe it's a way of being polite. Maybe it's really a way to tell him that she really likes him as a man. Now, the power of imagination begins to work. If he's a balanced person, he's considered all the options and he's thinking logically. It cannot be that after speaking to her 5-10 minutes on the phone, she's already sending me a love message. It cannot be. Let's not jump to conclusion. Take it step by step at the time to build a healthy relationship. But if it's a person that his life, imagination is way over the right balance, he's already come to his brother, wow, you don't know, I met this girl, you know, she's already in love with me, I got her heart in a minute, you have no idea, I'm a real Don Juan. And then when he already thinking about the date, she's already in my pocket. He comes, he feels, you know. And then when she said to him, get lost, it breaks his heart. He's depressed, 2 weeks he's in bed, leave me alone. Avi, come, dinner, leave me alone. What caused all this? Imbalance of the imagination in his mind. If the imagination was in the right balance, it would not happen. You understand? Sometimes it could be the other way around. Lack of imagination. It's in a lower level than what it should be. So when she tells him, you know, I actually would like to go with you on a date, and she names a place, immediately he already came to the conclusion that it's all a scam, that it cannot be. He doesn't even have hope. He doesn't even imagine that one day this pretty girl would be interested in someone like him. It can cause him the other way around. So therefore, imagination, as we can see, it's something real, although it can lead to something unreal and very painful. And let's continue. גורם לאדם שלא יכיר את כוחותיו האמיתיים. Confuse a person to such level that he miscalculate his real abilities. For instance, if someone says to him, I want you to be a salesman. No, I don't have the talent to convince people. I'm very bad with speaking. No, you can do it. Well, it's not such a big deal. You can do it. I'll teach you how to do it. No. I don't have it in me. Or the other way around. I give you an example. A person goes to yeshiva. All day they talk about Rav Ovadia Yosef and Rav Eliashiv and Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul and all these legends that gave their life for the Torah, Rav Shach, and they didn't move from the Gemara, Rav Eliashiv 60 years, and they became the biggest rabbis in the whole world. And he begins to learn, and he learns, and he learns, and he's thinking, in a few years, I'm going to be the new Rav Eliashiv. Everyone will come stand on life for me. And he learns 4 or 5 years. After 4 or 5 years, somebody comes and tells him, your achievement in learning is poor, below the average. And he gets depressed. That's it. It breaks him up. He leaves the yeshiva, doesn't want to wake up to daven, doesn't want to keep mitzvot anymore, doesn't want to touch the Gemara, doesn't want to go on shiduchim, nothing. Can go for years like that. What caused him that? He lived in illusion. He actually thought the same way Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul became what he became, and Rav Eliashiv or Rav Ovadia, I can also do it. Or not necessarily in religion. Somebody bought him guitar for his bar mitzvah. Right away he thought, I'm going to be the new Eric Clapton. All days practicing, na 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 na, 10 years he's like this, he cannot even plan a wedding. So now, after a while that he sees not becoming Clapton and he's not becoming even the feat of Clapton in guitar, he gives up, throw the guitar away, doesn't want to hear from it, nothing. His parents told him, why? You actually practice very nice. Come play for Moishe's bar mitzvah. Come, it's mitzvah, play, or play piano, whatever. No, no. Why is like that? To begin with a jump on a tree very, very high. Not everyone in guitar can be Clapton, and not everything in Torah can be Rav Ovadia. To begin with, you already went way beyond any possibility. There was no chance for you. Even if you sit 8 years straight on a Gemara without eating and sleeping and going to the bathroom and seeing anything, 8 years, you don't have the talent, the brain, the memory, and the ability of some of this great legend. Not everyone can be the same legend. So what do we see over here? Because of imbalance in the imagination, in the mind, it can lead a person to develop very high expectations from himself, and later when he cannot achieve those expectations, he collapses. Or it causes a person to have insecurity, to think, I am unable to be what my father wants me or what my Rebbe wants me, and to give up in advance something that he could have done easily. So now we understand how important is the power of imagination in the mind. So, גורם לאדם שלא יכיר את כוחותיו האמיתיים, או שהאדם מדמיין שהוא מסוגל לעשות דבר שבאמת זה מעבר ליכולתו, or a person imagining that he can do something that is way above his ability. I'm going to work very hard. I'm going to be like that. No, not everyone is meant for it. It's not your purpose. God never gave you the tools. He never gave you the tools. You understand? או שהדמיון מקטין את האמת. The imagination make it low, worse than what it really is. And a person is confident that he cannot do it when he actually can. So that's one out of the three, imagination. What's the second thing? We said fear. Fear. What's fear? יש בני אדם שיש להם תחושות פחד משינוי. The natural way of people afraid of changes. You may think, of course, everyone that his situation is great and perhaps is going to change for the worse, of course he's afraid of it. It's a natural reaction. He has $10 million. And the IRS want to take 9.9 out of it, out of his account as a penalty, so he doesn't sleep at night. Because if it will happen, he will become a poor person. He cannot afford the car he likes, the food, the restaurants, the gym, the friends that he have until now, the new house. He cannot afford all of that. So he's afraid very much of the change for the worse that would take him back 10 years in time. That's perfectly normal. Everyone is afraid of it. If you're not afraid of it, that means you're not normal. How you overcome this fear, we'll talk about it in next lectures. But to be worry and fear a downgrade in my situation, it's perfectly normal. But that's not what I'm talking here about. Even people are afraid of change for the same level. You're working as a lawyer in this firm for $100,000 a year. They're about to fire you. You apply to another firm and they accepted you for the same salary. $100,000, same job, same salary, same everything. You're going to the same courtroom. But it's a different office. It's 10 blocks away in Manhattan. Different train now. Different cafeteria. Different receptionist. Different boss. Things are going to be different. People are afraid of the change. Even if it's not down, there's no downgrade or upgrade. But people also afraid from upgrades. Many times people got offered much better jobs than what they do, meaning financially. They're going to make a lot more money. Thinking about all the changes they're going to have to do in their everyday lifestyle, they gave it up. No, I don't want. I'm happy with the way I am. You fool, you're going to make double. No, I'm good. Women afraid to change their cleaning lady. Even though the new one is 25, she's mamash a real demon. The other one already 60, it's very hard for her to bend down, to pick up things. She works slow, but she's a cleaning lady 20 years. But the other one is Habibi, a monster. No, I can't. How can I live without her? She's going to be a lot better. People are afraid. She knows in her mind that the new one will be a lot better. I'm happy the way I am. Don't offer me all these upgrades. That's also a fear that people have. That's why we have a say, "Kol ha'atchalot kashot, aval achar kach kal yoter." All beginnings are difficult, with no exception to the rule, even improvements, even upgrades. Everything is difficult in the beginning. Once you get used to it, it becomes easy and easier, and sometimes even better than before, than your previous position. So that's fear. Person is afraid from a change. That's why people are afraid to change. What, I'm going to walk with a yarmulke on the street now? Everyone will come to me and say, "Who died? We participate in your sorrow. Why nobody told us?" No, nobody dies. What? Nobody died and you go with the yarmulke? Well, you okay? You have cancer, chas v'shalom? What happened? No, Baruch Hashem, very healthy. I just got my results from the doctor. I'm a tiger. Business went down, huh? Bankruptcy? Let me know. I invested money in your company. No, business is booming. You have problem with your kids, huh? What, you cannot have kids? What's the problem? Your wife's sick? It will give you 500 possibilities. But one of the possibilities for sure he will not say. Did you see the truth and you want to say thank you to God for giving you so much and being so good to you? That option he will not ask. Why? But many people became religious just because of that. They saw the truth and they felt ungrateful. Look at me, what God does for me, and look what I do in return. They felt horrible. They started to change. They just couldn't enjoy the greatness knowing I'm so selfish and ungrateful. So what do we see over here? It's very interesting. That people are afraid of the change because what people will think about me, what they will say about me, all the questions, the annoying questions. People may come to the wrong conclusion about me. Maybe I'm going down in financials, in my health, maybe a tragedy happened, maybe it's because I couldn't get married, maybe because I got divorced, all kinds of things that go through their mind. Because of that, many people afraid to become religious, and those who still become religious, it's very difficult for them to walk with the kippah and tzitzit in the first few months. It sometimes takes years until they agree to put the kippah on. They have it in a pocket. Why? They go to the restaurant, they have to wash, they have to do amotzi, they have to do birkat hamazon, so the kippah goes up and down. But they're afraid to walk in the street. They come to the office, they're afraid. I know one person in the community, he's religious, in the community, he walks with kippah and he's a bold person. So he has kippah on, everything is fine. When he goes to his business, he wears a wig. Toupee. Nobody knows he's bald over there. Because he works there for who knows 40 years in that place when he was young and he had a nice blorit. Once over the years he started to lose his hair. Back then he already put a wig and nobody ever knew. So now after all these years, what are you going to one day take it off? And everybody said, "What, you became bald overnight? All these years you've been fooling us? Now he's stuck with this toupee for the rest of his life." People are afraid from the change and their reaction is going to cause. So that's called fear. Fear from the outcome, from the reaction. But the truth is, when a person gets used to change, he actually gets more and more personal confidence and gain. All you have to do is really to make the first step or two. You're going to get some reaction. People may laugh, maybe a joke or two behind your back. But, you know, these things quickly passed. Day or two, and that's it. People got used to you. That's it. Now, okay, 4 years, you're going to be like that. No one would raise an eyebrow. השינוי מהווה תיקון היצר לתחושות הפחד. The actual change is fixing the evil inclination to this feeling of fear. Therefore, it's like everything else in life. Once you begin to do it, first time it's difficult, 100% difficulty. Second time, 95%. Third time, 90%. Fourth time, 80%. 70%, 60%, 20%, 10%. Then there's no difficulty whatsoever. Then it turns around. If you want to stop doing it, then you're going to have 100% difficulty. But if you stop, first time you stop, 100% guilty feelings, difficulty, look at me, you loser, look what I became. Second time, 95% fear and difficulty. Third time, 90, 80, 70, 60, until you became a goy again. It works both ways. Fear from becoming more and more religious, but it goes away after a few times. אחרי הפעולות נמשכים הלבבות. That's what the Torah taught us. Not like people think. People think what I'm attracted to, what I like, that will be very easy for me to do and I would love it. So I want to do it. What I hate or what I don't like, this is very difficult for me to do. That's the other way around. What you decide to do, you begin to do, and it's guaranteed that you would love it eventually. You understand what I'm saying here or no? You don't like fish. Smell fish, you want to die. Ugh. Don't bring it next to me. They put you in jail now. Everyday fish. Nothing to eat. Fish! What are you going to do? You need to eat something. You're going to die. First day, you eat like that. You may even vomit once or twice. Second day, third day, fourth day, the hand went down. Fifth day, already a fork and a knife. 2-3 weeks later, Bukhari and fish. I can't live without it. What happened? Imagine now your ex come. What? You're eating fish? Years! I beg you to eat my Bukhari and fish. Years! You almost divorced me for the fish. Now you're eating it like this? Honey, I'm in jail. What do you expect? Yes! No problem. I understand you don't have a choice, but how you lick your fingers? That's what I don't understand. It's one thing I would see you eating and vomiting, okay, no? But look at you, fork and a knife, salt, pepper. That's the way it is. You can get used to everything. You don't believe me? When I joined the army, I was 18 years old. Grew up on the beach, like Goyim, the way we grew up, clubs of Tel Aviv, without going into more details. Like in Israel, they say, Amevin Yavin. Then, you have to go to the army. You show up that day. Right away, they take you to the barber. The only place the barbers are not Bukharians is the Israeli army. Over there, you don't choose. They make you a barber. What do you want to be? I don't want to be... Okay, you be a barber. But I don't know. The other barber will teach you. What do you have to know? You're shaving heads. You don't need to cut. It's all with machine. Tough. You come to the barber right away. You shave all your hair. You're already depressed. Wow, it took me years to grow up the bloat. No more hair. Next thing, they give you clothes that 5,000 soldiers already wore. Think about it. You don't get brand new. What size you are, Mizrahi? Here is he. Wear this. You look at this green.
ugly uniforms. You wear it. Go to the Afsanai, take blankets. The blankets from the time of Exodus of Egypt, Yetziat Mitzrayim. It takes an hour to shake it, to get the dust out, and it seems that the dust never gets out. More and more dust, and more, and you sneeze, and you become sick. And again, there's more dust. It's just unbelievable how much dust in those blankets, not to talk about lice. So how can you get used to this kind of life? You come from the beach, from the club, into such a jail. Is it possible you're gonna get used to it? What would you say if I told you the day I left the army I was crying? They made a mistake in my release date by 10 days and I didn't even tell them. I enjoyed to stay 10 more days in that jail. Why? You get used to it. That's it. It becomes your everyday life. You love it. You love it. You love the lousy potato mash over there and the chicken, the white chicken, and you like the horrible bathroom over there that you, as soon as you come there, you vomit when you see it. You get used to it. Even the rich kids, they didn't suffer anymore. You get used to it. This is the way Hashem made the person. Anything you want, you will get used to. Anything. So this is a very, very positive piece of information. Because most of the people think, I hate it, no chance I'm going to try it. No chance. But Hashem say you have to do it. But I hate it. But Hashem say you have to do it. All Jews have to do it. But I hate it. Hashem knew there will be people like you that hate it. But he still say every man must do it. And Hashem is not here in the world to make us suffer. There's no point of making people suffer. But everybody must do it. Why would Hashem do this to me? Don't worry, my friend. You only suffer for 2-3 times. It will not be relevant. After a few times, you'll love it. You know, once I told you the story how much I used to hate eggplants. I couldn't smell it. I had a trauma, I think. From the day my mother used to put it on the stove in the fire and all these strings, you know, looks like boogies from the eggplants, you know. I just saw it, I couldn't even breathe. Today, there's not one Shabbat without 5-6 kinds of eggplants on the table. This kind. Why? When I went to the army, I used to be in a very, very special place. Mamash, in the Air Force, with F-16, on alert, day and night, we sleep with shoes, uniform, very, very secret place, under the ground somewhere. So what happened over there? You're not allowed to go to the dining room like the rest of the soldiers in the base. We are a special unit. We have our own kitchen. We have to cook our own food. We cannot go out of the area. We are on alert, mamash. You cannot leave the premise. Even to the bathroom, you cannot be more than 2 minutes. And someone has to cover for you if something happened. It's a very, very serious thing. So we have to cook for ourselves. So they used to drop the thing and leave. They come every day, same brown eggplants like this every day. We had a guy from Haifa. I just found out a few months ago he passed away. Poor guy. He was sick and he died young. Ofer. May this year will be Leilu Nishmato. Ofer. He wasn't such a great cook, but compared to us, he was five-star chef. He took the loaf, the dog meat, inside the boxes, you know, we opened it up like tuna boxes, but it was meat. Imagine meat in a box 1 year old, inside with all kinds of... As soon as he opened the box, everyone fainted in the room, from the room of that. It's called loaf. The Israelis knows what I'm talking here about. Meat that was on a shell for 10 months. They opened it up, everyone fell and faint. An eggplant from the loaf, used to cut it, wash it with water, and then put it with some paprika, red paprika, whatever we had, some salt, fry it, make it like kebab. And the eggplant, slice eggplant like this, like that, but What, there's nothing to eat? You eat eggplant, eggplant, eggplant. In the end, you fall in love with that. Now I went to Canada, to Mount Tremblant over there. The guy puts eggplants all over me. I heard on the lecture, you like eggplant. All the eggplants next to me. Why? You get used to everything. That's the way it is. Now, food, big deal. I don't like it. I don't have to force myself to like it, unless it's the only food. But when it comes to Torah and mitzvot, you must do it. You don't have a choice. Hashem say you must do it. Hashem say I must do it. I better get used to it. I get used to it, I will love it. Third thing, so we cover imagination and fear. What is the third thing? Habits. Ergelim. We have a say, Ergel nahafach leteva. Ergel, when you used to something, you have to do it every day on a daily basis, or weekly basis, or hourly basis. It becomes your nature. It becomes your nature. Eventually, it's very difficult for you to get it out of your system. It becomes habit. Naturally, automatically, even when you sleep, you do it. Why? It becomes the new you. You know what it's like when you're becoming a driver and you start driving and you have a routine way. Every day you drive from home to work. And one time you have to drive to somewhere else, but it's the same way. You're passing from your work. It's very close. And one of the places you have to get off the exit to the work and to the new place that you're going today, you have to go two more exits. So if you're not thinking about what you're doing, you all of a sudden find yourself inside the parking lot of the work. What am I doing here? It's in your system already, habits. It took you, like you got used to it, that's it, that's how you go. So what's the problem with that? Remember, we are now explaining the three major reasons why a person is convinced that he cannot change. Imagination, fear, and now let's talk about habits. ככל שהאדם מתרגל להתנהגות מסוימת, the more a person is used to a certain behaving, כך יותר קשה לו לשנות את ההרגל. That's how difficult it is for him to change his habits. It's a fact, and I'm telling you from experience, that the older you get, the harder it is to become religious. The older you get, the harder it is to become religious. You may say, it should have been the other way around. Who is easier for him not to make sins? A person that is 60 or a person that is 17? 17, girls, school, you know, clubs, beach. He lives the life. This guy is already a grandfather. He doesn't have the same desire like this 17 years old kid. It's full of it. But reality is the other way around. What's the fact? It's a fact that every one of my Baalei Tshuva that was young became very serious. Went to yeshivot, coming to learn in the synagogue, coming to minyanim, grew in a much, much, much beautiful way. And the older people, very difficult for them. So they keep Shabbat barely. They put tefillin in the house. They barely eat kosher. They hardly learn. The older people, you tell them, come to the yeshiva to learn. Ah, I don't have the head to learn. What do you mean? You're only 60. People 90 years old learn in yeshivot. No, no, it's too much for me. It's good, it's good. I keep Shabbat. I eat kosher, Baruch Hashem. I put tefillin every day. Give me a break. It's too much for me. I cannot come to shul. I cannot come at night to learn. It's difficult for me. Why? He's already used to live like that 50 years. To change his entire system, to get up in the morning, to change the hours, to come to learn. Very difficult. But a young kid just started his life. He comes, he tries a few times right away. He makes an adjustment. He's not so deep. 40, 50 years in his habits. Things can change. One more thing. Rabbeinu Yonah, it says over there, that one of the reasons why Chazal said to a person to return and to do tshuva today and not to wait for tomorrow. Many people say, Rabbi, you convinced me that Torah is from God. I know that that's the right way to live. I promise you, it's just a matter of time until I become Shomer Shabbat and become religious. But right now, I cannot start. I have to finish first the college. I have 6 more months to finish the degree. And then we'll see what kind of job I'm going to have. I'm going to find the right time to become religious. The Gemara doesn't say like that. The Gemara say, return today. Don't wait for tomorrow, and needless to say, for next week or next year. Why? Why it's so critical? First, you don't know if you live tomorrow. Today you're alive. Maybe you die tomorrow. How many people got on a bus thinking, oh, I have another 8 years to live, and an explosion happened, and that's it? How many people were surprised in their life, terrorists, something? They had never dreamed that today is the last day of their life. They're young. Well, the whole life is in front of them. So, Chazal say, return today. Don't wait for tomorrow. Why? Because the longer you wait, the harder it is will be to become, to change and become Baal Tshuva. Why? Kevan shahergel nehfach liot yoter mushrash. The habits penetrates and go all the way down to the roots. Once it grabs the roots, almost impossible to change a person. That's it, you need a root canal now. It's not a simple feeling. Now it's a root canal to change you. Much, much, much harder. And we all know, Ergel na'afach leteva. Ergel is your second nature. There's the regular nature that you came to the world with, and the habits that you gain in your lifetime, creating a second nature. It wasn't a nature from birth, but it's a nature that came later on into your life. Those are the three reasons that causing a person to come to the conclusion that he cannot change. Imagination, fear, and habits. The Gaon Mivilna, the Gra, one of the greatest rabbis ever lived, it was over a little bit over than 200 years ago. This is what he writes. הרבה פעמים בחורים נשברים בגלל שהם מתאמצים מעבר לכוחותיהם. I said it 10 minutes ago. Many times guys in the yeshiva, they break. Why they break? They have a momentum, they learn X amount of time. Boom, and one day they collapse. No more waking up, no more coming to learn, doesn't want to come back to yeshiva, everyone begs him, what's going on with you? You were doing so great. I got many emails over the years about guys like this, ripping the heart to 1,000 pieces. I remember one time a guy wrote to me that he's finished already the whole Talmud. He was a super genius. Learning non-stop, all his rabbis unanimously decided that he's going to be the new Gdol Ador. And all of a sudden, he saw one thing in the internet, one bad film in the internet. He couldn't think Torah anymore after that. Turned him to a total negative thing. It became worse and worse and worse. And now, with a little bit left over, conscious that he still have left, he was reaching out to me to save him before he's done for good. And Baruch Hashem, Hashem helped him. I was the shaliach. Slowly, slowly, I got him back. And then after a few months, he wrote an email. That is, the tiger of the yeshiva. Baruch Hashem, it's like nothing happened. But how many guys like this did not reach out? Some of them became big kofrim, anti-Torah activists. When you think, you don't just think to a certain point and you stop. You're constantly sinking every day until the minute you died. There's no, when you're rising, you can rise, and stop. And then rise a little more and stop. And rise a little more and stop, or just stuck here and for the rest of your life. Like all the modern Baalei Tshuva. They rise a little bit, they got to a certain point, that's it. It's too much for me, more than that. I don't want big black yarmulke, I don't want beard, I don't want this, I don't want black and white, I don't want yeshiva all day, I don't want it. Up to here, and God forbid, not more than that. And that's how they stay until the day they die. And that's how they will stay until the day they die. They don't want to even consider continue to elevate. But when you fall, nothing holds you. To climb, you have to push. To fall, you don't have to do anything. You fall automatically. To climb on a mountain, you need to sweat and put a lot of energy. So you have to choose if you want to put energy to climb or not. If you choose to do it, you begin to sweat again and you climb another few more steps. So it's up to you. But when you fall from a mountain, you're constantly falling. There's no possibility to stop and review. You're constantly sinking. And that's what happened to the people who goes down. They never stop going down. They only get worse. In the beginning, it's something small, something bigger. Then they want pork only on purpose. And then they want this. And then he wants goyot only. And then he becomes gay. There's no limit to how much he's going to go down. What do we see? Then after 60 years, he said, don't look at me like that. I was in yeshiva when I was young. I was in yeshiva, yes.
Why does Hashem allow that to happen? A guy learning, and watches TV, internet, or whatever happens, and he loses it. That's serious stuff.
You know what, you're asking a good question. A person work on his health 30 years, eating healthy and going to the gym 4 hours every day. Then there's a poison in a cup. Someone put a few drops of poison and they told him, be careful, it's gonna kill you. But he was curious and he wanted to taste from the cup. So he took it, no one was there, and he drank from it and he died. So now you're asking me, why Hashem allowed him to die? That's what you're asking me. Why Hashem allowed him to die in 1 second after 40 years he was in a gym, eating healthy, working on his health, putting so much efforts in being healthy and muscular, and now in 1 minute he lost everything. Why? That's the way the world is. You can save yourself in a moment, you can, God forbid, destroy yourself in a moment. Same thing, it's not necessarily about religion. You can go to the casino and sit there for a week. You're only making money every hour. Another million. You double, another. Wow, you're already $100 million up. Then the dealer say to you, last shot. You have $100 million. You're gonna go for the whole amount, either $200 million or zero. That's usually how it ends. I'm all in. He puts everything in. He lost everything. So you ask, it's not fair. 1 week he was making, and 1 second he lost everything. That's the way Hashem made the world. Same thing, you can save yourself in a minute, one moment of sharp turn, and you already mityatzev al darkei atshuva. Same thing, chas v'shalom, a person can jump from a building and die. And it happens in a minute. But the good news is that the Torah told us where not to go. The Torah say, watch your eyes. Don't go into the internet. The internet have millions of dirty websites. Don't go over there. Something bad will happen there. People went there, they paid the price. The Torah say, don't go into drugs. Watch your health. You would lose control. Alcohol, drugs, all these things. The Torah warned a person from it. People want to try it. They lost their life. Or they messed up everybody else's life. This is the way the world is. The world can be very, very cruel. The world is cruel only because of people's choices. Naturally, the world is not a cruel place at all. The world is a fantastic, perfect, ideal place. The world became cruel because people chose the opposite of what Hashem told them. Think about it. Let's describe a world that no one will ever make a bad choice. Everyone would only always be spiritual, positive, choose only what Hashem wants. Nobody will ever steal. Nobody will ever murder. No one will ever rape. No one will ever take advantage on others. Everyone will be faithful. No one would lie. Everyone will help the poor. There would be not one poor person in the world, because there's so much money in the world that goes to 10 or 15% of the people. The rest are all suffering. If the greedy rich people would follow what Hashem really wants, they would also live comfortable, and they would give 99% of what they have to support another 10,000 people. Just imagine someone like Bill Gates, how many families he could have sponsored with his 60, 70 billion that he has, or his annual income. He gives a lot of tzedakah, so he's not a good example. But there's many, many rich people who refuse to give anything. So the world would be perfect. Perfect world. No hatred, no racism. Everyone wants to do the right thing. No one would be mechalel Shabbat. The temple would never be destroyed. The goyim will never be able to touch us. There will not be terrorism. The Arabs will be vanished a long time ago already. The only reason they're rising, as the Zohar say, because we are going down. The more we go down, the more power Hashem gives them to torture us. You understand? So what do you see from here? We wouldn't need police. We wouldn't need court. We wouldn't need armies. We would not have 99.9% of the sufferings we have. All the suffering we have, we brought on ourselves. So the question that you ask me, although it sounds a clever question, it's not a legitimate question. Why did Hashem allow it? Before you blame Hashem, ask why we allowed it. We could have lived otherwise. We didn't need to choose the evil. We wouldn't need all the things that we do. Life would be great. So now you ask me, okay, but so how can we act so stupid? How millions of us do the same mistake? The answer, yetzer hara. We have evil inclination. We do things that at the minute we do it, it's 1,000,000% clear to us, we're going soon to suffer for it. We know it. How many people, so let me just enjoy the moment. I'm gonna deal with the consequences later. I know I'm gonna pay a heavy price for it. I know. And he does pay a price later on. Sometimes he look back and he say it was worth it. I'm suffering, but the hour pleasure that I had was worth it. Sometimes he bang himself to the wall and say, what a fool I am. For 1 hour I enjoy, look how much I suffer. You understand? One example is starting to smoke. He wanted to impress the guys in the neighborhood. Come on, don't be a loser. Be a man. No? So he's going to get 5 minutes of attention. Wow. He's one of us. Very good, buddy. Hey, give me five. 5 minutes of attention, 6 years of suffering. Not to talk about hundreds of thousands of dollars went on those stupid cigarettes. Always smell, always cough, cancer, problem. Half of the women didn't want him on a shidduch. What normal woman wants a man that smokes? If I was a woman, and all the men that would come on a date would smoke, I would rather stay single for the rest of my life than living with someone that smells like a rat. It's terrible smell. Sometimes I give rights to people. They stand on the street in Monsey, all kinds of religious people that smoke. So when they stand outside, they smoke. So when I pull over to pick them up, they take the last time, you know, to take advantage. Why? Every cigarette is a dollar now. So you need a mortgage for a pack of cigarettes. So they go like this, and I say, here he goes, here we go again. He goes like this, now he comes into my car and he breathes on me. You understand? And then a week later, I smell him in my car. I promise you. A week later, oh, you drive, you open the window, now it doesn't go away. It stays in there, in the chairs, in there. That's how horrible the smell of it is. You know, I can tell you now, if we sit over here and a guy would be two blocks away, smoking a cigarette, coming towards here, I would tell you somebody's with a cigarette is about to enter. That's how bad is the smell. When I used to be in a yeshiva for all day, I used to learn with my chevruta. I used to tell him in 10 seconds someone will open the door. He was smoking outside. Wait, 10, 20 seconds maximum. Somebody walks in. Did you smoke outside? Yes. How did you know? Smell it from here. Horrible smell. In a park, we used to go Friday to play a little bit, to run. Somebody smoke 200-300 yards away. I cannot breathe in a game. 200 yards away in an open park. I smell him. Imagine you have to live with someone like this in the same room all your life. It's, you know, they say in Hebrew, al ta'am ve'al re'ach, y efshar li'itvakeach. On taste and smells, there's no way to argue. You cannot tell a person, this is delicious and this is horrible, because he can say the other way around. This is delicious and this is horrible. Right? He likes meat, he hates meat. He likes fish, he hates fish. For him it's delicious, for him it's poison. Same thing smells. You come to the duty-free, 5,000 smells. One guy wants to buy his wife perfume, sweet, gives headache. The other guy, that's exactly what I like. Different taste and smell. Colors, one person like this color, one hates this color. Hashem made us different. The Gemara says, Keshem sheparzufehem shonim, kach de'otehem shonot. Same way that there's no face similar to the other by people, that's how their opinions are never going to be the same. Even two rabbis that grew up in the same yeshiva, with the same rabbi, they learned from the same books, same ideology, same shita. This guy is Litai, this guy is Litai. This guy is Talmid of Rav Shach, this guy is Talmid of Rav Shach. He isn't from Ponovich, he's from Ponovich. They both went the same days, the same shiurim, the same gemarot, the same, everything the same. Now you're going to have a conversation, you're going to see they have differences. Right? That's the way the world is. There can never be 100% the same opinions. It can be 90-something percent the same. But there's never going to be the same. Why? Because there's going to be at least one thing that they disagree on. This is the way the world is. Mamash, time is running out. So, the Gaon Mivilna explained, הרבה פעמים בחורים נשברים בגלל שהם מתאמצים מעבר לכוחותיהם. Many times people break because they go beyond their abilities. He's fasting, mikveh every morning. Right away grew a beard, sweeping the floor when he walks. All day like this. But after a few months, it was too much for his to carry. You put too much weight. You see, you have two donkeys. One is very strong and one is small and skinny. You want to put 300 kilo on each one of them. For the first hour, they're both holding it. But after a few hours, the skinny one will collapse. The other one is standing. There's no same abilities between the first and the second one. Same thing by people. Not every student can absorb the same amount of learning. Some students in today's world, it's a crime in some of the yeshivot that they force them to learn 10 hours a day. Force them. And Gemara, almost all day Gemara. That later on will cause a very big problem in their life. They can even, to the point that he can even go completely off the derech. Some kids, they cannot learn full days. So what? They're not going to be Rav Ovadia. So what's the problem? I don't understand. Everybody has to be Rav Eliashiv. He needs to learn half a day, and half a day he has to learn something with the hands. To be a carpenter, a plumber, electrician, something. Teeth technician, jewelry, tzoref, something. There are some places like this. If you force on a kid sometimes more than his ability, eventually he would lose even the what he could have absorbed, even that he won't get. Because putting too much, the utensil explode. If you have a glass, it can hold X amount, and you put with pressure more and more and more, and the glass crack, even the 1 liter that he could hold, in the end leaks out. It left with nothing in the end. In the religious world, there are some common mistakes that costing us big time. I wish I had the power to change it. The system is way over my abilities. One of the mistakes that we do in our religious world is, for us, everyone that learns good in yeshivot is a tzaddik and will give our life for him. The system, the yeshivot, the teachers, the Rashi Yeshivot, wow, great, Steingin, great guy. Everyone that is not doing so great in learning is not into Gemara, Shegetz, Rusha Merusha, send him out of the way, and right away gets out of the system and he becomes a bum on the street of Lakewood or Muncie or Borough Park or Queens and Brooklyn and everywhere else. And from there, I wish it would only be this. At least he can find a job, be a delivery guy, do something with his life. But usually it ends with drugs and crimes and arrest and suicide. It can even get to prostitution. It can get to horrible places that you would never believe. You understand why? Because a kid that doesn't have what to do with his life, what do you expect him? What is he, where is he going to go? He's going to go to place that people give him love and attention, even though it's fake love. He's going to join the junkie in a park. They all inject needles, but they're going to welcome here. Hey, buddy, what's up? What happened? They threw me out. I'm alone now. I have nowhere to go. Come, join us. So he joined the ride. Why is he joining them? How many times in his life he was warned not to touch drugs? He's going to mess up his life. But isn't the point that he has nothing to lose? Nobody gives me attention. The junkies give me attention. He goes to them. He becomes one of them. And then you hear, 17 years old boy died. Close to 150 boys and girls like this died in 1 year in the ultra-Orthodox communities, dying from drugs and suicidal acts. You understand what's happening here? I don't have to tell you what happened in the secular world. It's probably a lot worse. I don't know. I don't have the statistic. Much, much worse. But even in a religious world, it happens. It happens a lot. So, the Gaon Mivilna say, don't jump above your ability. You don't have to occupy the world. It's a mistake to tell every kid, you must be Rav Ovadia. You must. You have to do it. You have to do it. Because then anything he will achieve, he would feel like a loser. If he's going to be a local rabbi of a community, it will still feel like a loser. Why? Because since he's a baby, you must be Rav Ovadia, you must be Rav Eliashiv, you must be, you have it in you, you're a loser, you're not putting enough. So in the end, if it's going to be a nice Talmid Chacham, not worth anything in his eyes. Why? Because he had very high expectation. That's if he's not going to collapse. So the Gaon Mivilna continue. האדם לא יקפוץ מעל מדרגתו, זה יסוד חשוב שצריך לשים לב. This is a very important foundation that you have to pay attention to. The system of the learning and keeping the mitzvot and the rest of Avodat Hashem has to be according to the ability of the student. Where does it say it in the Torah? Chanoch lana'ar al pi darko. Educate the boy based on his way, his ability. He's attracted to music, very good, take advantage on it. Give him music. From that, you give him what he likes and he's happy, he will be more open to learn also. You take away the music from him, he will never agree to learn one page in his life. Revenge. You took my life. I don't want to hear from you. Anything. I hate you. Give him what... If he wants horrible, he wants to eat pork all day. It's not in our hand to give it to him. But if things that he wants, it's not the end of the world. It's not a violation, it's not a sin. Why taking it away from him? He wants to play basketball an hour a day. He likes sport, he likes to run, to jump, put some energy, play with some of his friends. Sure, you Russia, you don't learn, you Amaretz. Why? Give him the 1 hour, he will do a lot better in the 9 hours. That's already too much. You send them to me, I'll lower it to 1 hour. Yes. But you know what? Sometimes it's better he plays 6 hours basketball than you force him to do what he hates, and then when he becomes independent, he runs and becomes a goy. Especially in today's generation. In today's generation, things that we are able to do hundreds of years ago, we cannot do. Hundreds of years ago, it was mitzvah to hit the kids, to give them a smack for everything they do wrong. Today you cannot give them one smack a year. 99% of the smacks will end in a tragedy. Not that many kids, with the way the ego is and the way they grew up in places like America and Europe and Israel, they will not react to the smack like kids reacted 200 years ago. No. 200 years ago, the kid was so embarrassed, he didn't care about the smack. He cared about what I've done wrong. How could I have done such thing? Understand? The smack would actually be a relief for him. I got what I deserve, very good. Because they raised them differently. Today it's not like that. Today give him a smack in the back of his mind, call 911. My father is a Nazi. He's torturing me. He doesn't understand, he cares about him. And any speech you give him won't help. If you're going to come to your son or to your daughter and say, do you know why I gave you this punishment? If I wouldn't give you the punishment, then that's a sign I don't care about you. I don't care, you die, you live, you be tzaddik, you be rasha. I don't care. I let you do whatever you like. But the fact that I gave you this punishment, that's because I care about you. These speeches, although they are 100% true, don't work anymore. They don't work. You know why? How is it possible that the children change so much in this generation than 2, 3, or 4 generations ago? How? Ask your parents or maximum your grandparents. When the way they grew up, if it was anything near the way the children grow up today. I'll tell you, you're crazy. Even by the goyim, not only by Jews, by the secular, same thing. Why is it happening now that you cannot tell musar to kids? You cannot give them punishments, you cannot give them a smack, you cannot force them to do anything that it's correct to do. These things that used to be a way of life cannot no longer work. Why? The answer is, Rabotai, many people don't know it. We can blame the internet, we can blame society, we can blame liberalism, we can blame politically correct culture, we can blame a very immorality in the world and no ethic. We can blame a lot of things. We can learn the level of the education that dropped in the schools. Everything is correct. But there is something beyond that. The Gemara said that in the end of time, Hashem will send back souls to the world in reincarnations for one last final opportunity and a chance to correct themselves. One final chance. Either they make it or the Chas v'Shalom be destroyed for eternity. They'll make it lechaye olam or they'll make it lederaon olam, like the Rambam writes in the Gemara. So all the garbage of all the generations, all the failures of all the generations are now coming for one final chance in reincarnation. So it's a collection of 7.5 billion horrible souls that came back to the world, with some exception to the rules. There's some great souls who were sent to help the generation. There's a concept like this. Like the Ari HaKadosh say, I will come back if Hashem will agree to help the generation. And he was perfect tzaddik. He didn't have to come back in reincarnation. He came back as the Rashash 250 years later. Rabbi Shalom Sharabi, the big Mekubal from Bet El. That was the Gilgul of the Rashash. And Rabbi Akiva came back as the Ramchal. Ramchal lived 39 years. This is the years that Rabbi Akiva was a goy. Like a goy, Am Haaretz. He became a tzaddik, age 40. The 4 years that he lost, Hashem sent him back. And because otherwise you cannot live 39 years old and write more than 100 books. And every one of them, you need to live 80 years to be able to write. He didn't live 500 years. He only lived 39 years. He was a little kid. Plus he was diamond cutter, melateshi alomim. So a few hours of his time he was working to make a living. How did he reach such a level, the Ramchal? Or the Ari that also lived 39 years. Or Rabbi Nachman Mibreslev, also 39 years. Very, very short life. If a person will be born today and his father put him in yeshiva age 3. 3! Super smart kid. And he will learn 36 years. He would be Ramchal, or the Ari, or the Gaon Mivilna in his dreams. They won't reach 1% of their level. So what do you see? They're special souls that Hashem sent to help the generation. But Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, already 2,000 years ago, in the time he wrote the Zohar, he said, the last generations before Mashiach come, I, the perfect Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, the perfect legendary Tana, would not want to live in that generation. The Gemara say, Achutzpat iskeh, people will be all arrogant. People will have no shame, no dignity, no honesty, no shame from their parents, no respect to their in-laws. Everything will be the opposite of what it used to be. Everything. The level of faith will be low. Horrible. The Gemara brought a list of what's going to happen. The face of the generation, like the face of the dog. Why dog? From 2 million animals, they picked a dog. Why? Because dog is the most arrogant animal. From all 2 million kinds of animals, dog is the most arrogant. Although dog will give his life for his master, and he can help a lot, but in his behaving, is the most arrogant. What does it mean, most arrogant? If you come to the safari, and there's a lion staring at you behind the fence, and you go like this to the lion, he walks in his dream, doesn't even look at you. Like in Israel, he say, Lo ro'eh otcha mimeter. Doesn't even look at you. You go to the leopard, you bang on the glass in the Bronx Zoo, wake up, you fool. Doesn't move bichlan. You come to the rhinoceros, you even give him a smack, he doesn't move. You come to a dog behind the fence, you walk in the street, in one of the private houses, you don't even look at him, Bichlal. You just walk. It's going to kill you. If you go like this to him, forget about it. Wow. If there was no fence, it would rip you apart. That's the face of the people today. You say, you read a pasuk from the Torah, the next day in the internet, may you die, your children should die. They know you read a part from the Torah. They curse you. What is it? Pnei ador ki pnei hakelev. Pnei ador ki pnei hakelev. So this is the children we got. What do you want? He's from horrible generation, and he's from horrible. He's a big sinner. You have to raise them now. It's not what it used to be, Rabotai. But here and there, you still find kids, Baruch Hashem, that are nice and clean. They love to learn. They still have things to correct, obviously. They have their issues, of course. But this is one of the main reasons. That's why we shouldn't eat our heart too much. Sometimes we give, we give, we give, and the kids are still not perfect. Why is it? Because to begin with, the mission was almost impossible. To begin with. This is what the Gaon Mivilna say. If you develop high expectation, you could never ever reach that level. When you won't reach it, you will break. Don't climb too high. One step at a time. Today I have to be tzaddik. What's tomorrow? Tomorrow it's a new day. You understand? It's true that the Gemara say, חייב האדם לומר מתי יגיעו מעשי למעשי אבותי אברהם, יצחק ויעקב. Person has to say, meaning to think, when will my action reach the level of my fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Every fool knows that no matter how much you dream to be Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, you will never be 1 millionth of their level. 1 millionth. You know, divide Abraham to 1 million levels, you will be in the lowest one. If you're lucky, you're going to jump into the fire for the sake of Hashem. You're going to take your son and sacrifice him after you waited 100 years for him. You would run to save your nephew and risk your life for this loser who took away all the money from you and left. You would risk your life to save your nephew. Who is he that I should die for him? I told him, choose a side. He chose the green side. He left me in a desert. Not only I gave him sheep and cattle, I gave him shepherds, I made him rich in his lifetime. Now he sent his uncle to the desperate dry sign and he goes to the good sign. Someone like this deserves that I should risk my life for him? But he went and did. And many other things. Look, Avraham, look at Yaakov. The level that they reach, these people. Yaakov Avinu, 14 years, did not sleep on a bed. In Yeshivat Shem Va'ever. 14 years, did not sleep on a bed. We have people in our generations like this. That they don't sleep on a bed. Only while they sit. Rav Kook from Tveria. He doesn't sleep. He sleeps only when he sits. There's no such thing bed by their life. In my own eyes saw him sitting 3 days straight on a chair. In a seminar that we had in New Jersey 20 years ago. They invited him to be the guest of honor to pray that the seminar will be successful. 3 days he sat in front of the Gemara without leaving the room. 3 days. And then what happened? When we woke up, we came in the morning to pray Shachrit in the nets. Soon as he heard a little noise, he was falling asleep while he was sitting. Learning, waking up, like this. Woke up, again, another day of learning. Like this, all his life. You understand? I had the zchut to be very close with him. A few times when I went to Israel, I went, he got me into the secret room, 3 feet by 3 feet. It's a tiny room that he learns to sit there and learn all the time in his house. He is the one who said 5 months ago that soon there will be fire all over Israel, but he doesn't have permission from Shamayim to tell. And exactly what he said. Who would guess? Who would come and say fire all over Israel? Huge fire all over Israel, he said. 5 months before. Special people. There are people like this. There are. But still, they don't reach even 1% of the level of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. What about the ordinary people? So what's the point here? I make myself look like a fool? When will I be like Avraham Avinu? Oof, when? Put him in a mental institution right away. It's not normal. Right or wrong? It's like somebody works a waiter in a restaurant, making $10 an hour, and you hear him say, things are not working out. When will I already be Bill Gates? When? So if he had a shidduch planned, the parents of the girl will tell her, are you sure you want this Lola, this cuckoo guy? When will I be Bill Gates, Rabbi, when? That's when we're going to make $20 an hour. Then we worry about Bill Gates. So why the Gemara say, at least you have permission to dream. You dream to be Avraham, maybe you'll be one day rabbi. But if you don't dream about anything, what are you going to be? Mamash, before we finish, I read to you from Proverbs, Mishle, Shlomo HaMelech, 3,000 years ago. Proverbs 19:2. Gam belo da'at nefesh lo tov, ve'atz beraglaim chote. When the Gaon Mivilna say what he said? From his opinion? No. It's all based on the words of King Solomon. ואת ברגליים חוטא, רגליים, it's feet, right? Legs. אץ ברגליים, when a person get himself used to behave good, then it becomes his new nature. From now on, he's no more angry, no more selfish, no more stingy, caring. He becomes a much better person. But if he's gonna run with his legs fast, one level, another stair, another stair, another one, quickly, he's gonna fall to a category of a sinner. Atz beraglaim chote. Chote? I run to Hashem. What chote? I run. Tell me, come, be tzaddik. Psh, like a machine gun. No, no, no. Gotta build a foundation. Then first floor, then second. You're gonna build 100 floors with no solid foundation. Everything will collapse. So he says, King Solomon, what's the explanation? The Gra, the Gaon Mivilna explained the Pasuk in Proverbs. What does it say? When a person have to climb from one level to the next one, it's like climbing a ladder. He will not jump on steps. He has to go in the right way. If he will jump to a level that is not there yet, that's considered atz beraglaim, rush with his legs. It's jumping already. Kofetz lemida gvoa asher lo lo. Ve'hu chote. Not that he's not smart, not that it's not recommended, not that it's dangerous. All of the above is correct. But that's not what they say. He's a sinner. Sinner. Nevertheless, he is considered to be a sinner. Why? He's jumping too much. וחסר מכל כי יפול ממנה. Just a matter of time until he falls completely to the ground. You know, when I was teaching in yeshiva for a few years Gemara, I had guys that on a weekly basis, I used to bring guys to the yeshiva from the lectures, and they get into the system. And some of them, they used to right away within a month already starting to grow a beard, putting a big black yarmulke, and then a month or two later they already have black hats. So technically after 2-3 months they already look like Hasidim from birth. In reality they barely know how to wash their hands. They just started. They don't know Aleph Bet. They learned Ben Ishchai, Shana Rishona, Lachot, a little bit Yalkut Yosef, Ovadia Yosef, Rav Ovadia. They don't really know that much. I was the policeman to stop them from running. I used to tell them, you're making a very big mistake. You're growing now this beard, you're not in this level. To grow a beard, that means it's like a stamp, a status. I am a Ben Torah. I give my life for the Torah, for the mitzvot. I'm ultra, ultra orthodox. But you're not in this level yet. Maybe you dream to be there. Maybe it's your will. Maybe it's your wish. But you're still not there. What's going to happen? You're now very excited. You have the energy of the beginning. Hashem helps you. It's the first steps. So you're going to run, 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 because you want to look like the rabbi that is there already 20 years. That's your goal. So you think that by looking like him, you're really going to be him. But it's not working like that. It's only from the outside. It's a custom. It's a Purim custom. What happened later on? Few problems comes out of it. One is when he goes to public places, he doesn't behave like that rabbi that teach him in a yeshiva. He behaves like a secular guy from the neighborhood because he's only in yeshiva 2 months. He still have the dirty words. He still look around, you know, check around what's going on. He's still not 100%. It's not exactly there yet. And then it become Chilul Hashem. People look at him. Look at this rabbi, how he behaves. What rabbi? It's 2 months in yeshiva. People start kissing his hand. Chacham, chacham, tfaddal. Come here, chacham. What chacham? 2 months ago was naked on a beach in India. Chacham. That's the way the world is. People judge you by the way you look. And there, now, ooh, I'm already a chacham. Look, in 2 months I became better than his rabbi. Then he comes back to the yeshiva, the rabbi is teaching, he knows better. Ah, what are you talking about? It's not like that. I'll prove to you, you're wrong. You already feel, I'm the new Gaon Mivilna. And then 2 or 3 months later, he collapses and becomes gangster, and Shem Yirachem. Or he goes to Uman and he met Christina over there. She took him away. They show now in Israeli television, hundreds of guys with beards and peot like this, with Russian half-naked prostitute, going to celebrate all night in Uman. All over Israel on television. The biggest Chilul Hashem in the history of the Jewish nation. Why? This guy ever learned as a one good year in yeshiva in his life? Chutz mi nonsense that they brainwash him all over. Did he ever change one midah? Already grow a beard like this, peot like this, hats, all kinds of tzitziot all over. That's not the right way. It's all external and fake. That's why a person has to grow in a right way. Just like in business, by the way. Not only in religion. Many people went into real estate. They had money. They started to buy, renovate, and sell. Buy, renovate, and sell. So they started, you know, they have big eyes. It's another good deal, another good deal. Good deals will always come. But they don't want to lose one. So they borrow, and another one, and another one, and then they borrow in private lending. They pay 3 times more than a bank. Why? Because he's already thinking, I'm gonna 2 months, I'm gonna sell it in 2 more months, in 4 months I'm gonna pay him the interest like this, I'm gonna make a lot of money, and he buys 30 different places, and it's enough that 3 or 4 of them will be stuck. There will be no permit, or something went wrong, or a pipe exploded, or burglars broke in and made vandalism, stole the bathrooms. There's many unexpected things happening. All of a sudden the market fell down, they came on the news and say something, and then he gets stuck, and from here he collapsed completely and go bankrupt. That's what happened. Why? Because he did not want to lose the possible potential profit. That's not how you grow in real estate. You buy one property, you finish, you sell, you got the money, you buy another one. You have to know your limit. You go way over your ability. You have 40 houses out there. And you run out of money. You cannot fix them. You don't have money to renovate them. You begin to lend, you pay high interest. Things do not work. You cannot find customer 1, 2, 3. Customer could not get a mortgage. Now you have to start another 6 months. In the meantime, it costs you high interest. You collapse. That's what happened to a lot of people. They could have made millions if they will wait an extra few more months before they jump. They want to occupy the world in 1 week. And they go bankrupt and they owe millions in the end. Everything they lose, they run away. This is what happened to people. You need to learn how to grow. At the same time, you don't sit back and wait 20 years until you jump 1 step forward. It's also not good. It has to be steady, but surely, not to waste time. Now I'm going to wait a year. It's enough. Up to here, give me a year rest. What do you mean a year rest? Adam la'amal yulad, you came to the world to earn, not to rest. You're going to rest later on forever. Now it's time to earn. But you need that Torah, you need a rabbi to tell you, Rabbi, I want to do this. Should I do it or not? Rabbi, I'm 3 months Baal Tshuva. I want to start doing all kinds of things that my uncle does. Your uncle is 15 years. Or you want to do the same thing like him? You're normal. When you go to the gym, 15 years is lifting weights, and you're just 3 months there. You want to jump to his level after 3 months? You know what would happen to your muscles? You'll be paralyzed. You add another 2 pounds for the next 2 months. And then come back, we will evaluate you, maybe another 2 pounds. And then another 2, 3 months, maybe another 2 months, or maybe not, maybe you're still not ready. You want to jump to 300 pounds overnight. This is it. conclusion of the lecture today, three things makes a person say, I'm unable to change. Imagination is too much or lower than what it should be. The imagination of the person. And the second thing is habits. That a person is already got used to do something for so many years. And now we say, after all these years, I'm going to change. And the third thing, fear. Fear from the change. Fear. Even to change, meaning upgrade. Not to talk about downgrade, which is much scarier. Those are the three that force a person to stick to what he is and die as a loser. And the second important thing we learned in today's session, that people develop high expectation way more than potential abilities. They are dreaming about being in a level that they can never reach in their entire life, even if they'll be perfect. And as a result of that, when they don't get there, they collapse to zero or worse. Meaning, even to grow, you have to grow in the right way. And the three things about the imagination, the fear, and the habits, we will address in future lectures how to overcome these obstacles. Because that's what caused a lot of people for not being able to change and stick to what they are, and chas v'shalom, they die secular and lose everything in the end. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.